This video is a presentation of our artificial intelligence wavefront analysis technology. We use neural networks and machine learning to extract wavefront information from many different types of optical systems automatically from simple images using just a classical camera without the need of specific hardware for that. And from those wavefronts, we can rebuild all the specification and performance of the optics. In this presentation, I'm going to use a small bench designed to show you that live. The bench is made of a small telescope. The telescope itself is a simple achromat with a clear aperture of 24 millimeters and a focal length of 300 millimeters, which gives us an f12.5 system. This is the scope. On the back of it, we have a beam splitter. On the vertical leg, there is a pinhole 10 microns with a white LED behind it. On the horizontal leg behind, there is a camera who takes a picture of the pinhole. The pinhole is set at the focal plane of the achromat of the telescope. In front of the telescope, we have a good flat mirror on the mount, which can be adjusted for tilt tip. The idea is the image of the pinhole is seen by the camera in a double pass. A light goes through the beam splitter, through the scope, reflect back here, and is seen by the camera. The camera is set to a location intrafocal, which means we have a defocus image, and this is in purpose to do a phase diversity in a process of recovering the wavefront from a defocus image of the PSF. So let's have a look how does it work live. I have an application running now and getting an image every 1 second or so from the camera. In front of the camera, by the way, I have a green filter to narrow the bandwidth a bit, around 550 nanometer. Since the source is a white one, this way we can make the system not monochromatic, but a little bit more narrow band. So what you can see now live is the actual defocus image of the pinhole seen by the camera as we speak, and I can adjust the tilt tip of the mirror to be sure it is more or less centered to the cross, and the cross, the red cross on the screen, is the location of the center of the sensor. So if we magnified this just a little bit, we will see the defocus image. Here we have three wave RMS without any central obstruction. This whole technology works with central obstruction, and by the way, it can work by analyzing more than one image here. We could have different defocus image of different pinholes and analyze the whole field of view at once, not only on axis, but off axis all together, which is quite unique capability if you are interested by getting all information across the field at once, like in a corner, in a center, in the same time, field curvature and other things. Three-wave RMS with no central obstruction give you roughly 10 PTV, and if you look carefully, you should see 10 rings of the defocus image. This is my raw image from the camera. You can see here there is the frame counter who tells us every second or so I get a new image coming from the camera. Okay, so now I can look at the wavefront reconstruction from the neural network technology and all the pre-processing and calculation behind, extracting the Zernike coefficient. And this is what you see live. You can see this scope on axis. It's 87% or so, 88%, you know, somewhere between 88 and 90% Sterrell ratio. We have the basic astigmatism, comma, trefoil and spherical aberrations. Here we don't do more. We can, of course, compute more Zernike, but we don't because it's mainly for an application of optical collimation, alignment, and it's good enough for the job. So you see we have a little bit some astigmatism, little bit some comma, little bit some trefoil, not much though. The dominant one is a spherical aberration, and you would expect that because it's a single achromat, which means you have some level of spherical. There is no other lens to correct for the spherical. On the left here, you have the actual defocus value. We designed the hardware to be defocused by 7.1 millimeter, which for that optic, give you the three wave RMS. and you see the system records 7.176 millimeter. So the system can retrieve information like that, which could be used for automatic focusing, for instance. We will know if we would have a focuser by how much we need to move to be in focus. You have the Thrill ratio, you have the RMS error, which is 18 of a wave here, and the PTV, which is around a third and a fourth of a wave. This color plot shows you the wavefront. In color red, you have the peak. In blue, you have the trough. Here, you have a color bar. And you can see typically the shape of spherical dominant aberration in the system. The neural network rebuild the defocus image from the actual one. And you can see that what the neural net found is this. This is the actual monochromatic 550 nanometer image of the defocus PSF at the same 7.1 millimeter. Using the Zernike means we can rebuild the PSF, and this is the PSF of the system at best focus. Of course, in this case, we remove the defocus term. I have here the square root of the PSF to improve the display, and if I use it, you see a bit better the ring. So you can still see some level of coma here if you look carefully and astigmatism a bit, but not much. We are, you know, almost 90% Thrill ratio, as you can see here. And this is the wavefront in 3D. We see the trough in the middle and on this side, and the maximum coming from the spherical aberration, which is the dominant one of here. Now let's see if we can create some level of aberration in the system. We can do that by tilting the mirror, the front mirror, going off axis. Going off axis means for a system like this one, I'm going to get more aberration because I have a single achromat with no other lens, and that will create some level of aberration, mainly astigmatism and coma. You see I'm moving live. So along the diagonal of the chip, which would bring me around 10 millimeter away from the optical axis with this camera, we start to see some level of astigmatism. The shape of the defocus PSF is elongated here. So let's look at what the neural network finds. The reconstruction of the wavefront gives us this, and we clearly see astigmatism now. So now our Thrill ratio dropped 72, 73. Persons so are below the diffraction limit, around the 12th of a wave, RMS error, and you see typically the sign here of the astigmatism with the next aberration being the spherical. We can see the PSF, which is obviously a little bit different with a typical astigmatism pattern. The square root of it is probably a better, so we see a little bit more coma now, and astigmatism. I'm going to move back the defocus PSF to near the optical center of my system again, and show you another thing which is quite cool. So as I said before, we could actually compute this wavefront analysis for the system with more than one pinhole or other type of pattern. You know, here it's a pinhole, it could be a collection of pinhole or other kind of patterns across the field. Using the neural net technology we have, machine learning, we can do that and analyze the whole field at once for on and off axis aberration, which will be very difficult to do with a classic Shackartman sensor system without moving anything. If I'm close to the center again, so we can see we are back to a dominant spherical aberration with 5 to 4 hundredths of a wave error, RMS. So my next test is to tighten a bit more the screw who support the flat mirror. The flat mirror is mounted on a kinetic mount with set screws. I can turn the set screw, one of them, a little bit, and if I do that, I will start to pinch the mirror, and you will see distortion coming from this, and you don't need much to see those. So I think the best way to see it is to monitor live the wavefront, and you can see a strong level of astigmatism and a drop of the Strel ratio. The set screw has a nylon tip, so eventually the stress will be released slowly and the system go back more or less to a diffraction limited system. You can see my Strel ratio goes up here slowly because the mechanic is settling. You see a strong level of astigmatism with some coma, still the same level of spherical, which makes sense because it's coming from the lens. You can see the PSF of obviously with quite some astigmatism, the square root of it is probably a good way to see that. But let's release the stress fully and we should be back where we were before, with mainly a spherical aberration. Here we are, and we are back to the situation where we were before. That's an example of application live, and we can go at the video rate. The main reason we get an image every second is because this is the test prototype software. We could go at video rate. The calculation time for the neural net is pretty fast. There is no iteration like in curvature sensing or this type of things. It's a direct calculation of the inverse mathematical model of the Aradian's transfer equation. Now we can do the same thing with an actual scope with a central obstruction reflector, and I can show you here a little bit some of this. It's an example here from an RCT, Richard Cretien scope. It's a 10-inch scope open at 8, and it's under seeing condition because I'm actually looking at an actual defocus star, and you can see the effect of the seeing here. We are defocused by roughly 12 wave PTV. The central obstruction is around 45%, and you can see the scintillation effect of the seeing, as well as of course the blur from the seeing. We don't see much of the rings, and from there we can use a neural network, the same kind of neural network. This one was trained with central obstruction, and we get the wavefront. In that scope we have a collimation issue. The Strel ratio is pretty low, 23%. The defocus in that one, because the nature of the optic, is minus 4.8. I'm extrafocal in this example. My total RMS error is a fifth of a wave, roughly one wave PTV. You see we are dominated by astigmatism, and we have some level of trefoil and spherical, which probably is related to the spacing between both mirrors. And the system can also give me the local seeing at the time of the acquisition of the image with the star, and it was a little bit above 3 arc seconds. Besides the fact it was a poor seeing though, we could compute a pretty good accurate value of the wavefront. We are in good agreement with the Shack-Hartmann analysis. You can see here the PSF, which is pretty ugly. That's the square root of it to show better the rings, but it doesn't look good, which you can even see it in 3D. We typically see astigmatism and coma. You can see the reconstructed defocus PSF, and we clearly see some level of coma and astigmatism, and spherical, of course, here. So to summarize, this system can be used to do many kinds of wavefront and optical analysis. Here it's an example with an actual star or an artificial star like the pinhole. We could use more than one at the time to analyze the whole field of view, to extract more information in terms of aberration of axis, but also field curvature or these type of things. And we are not limited to pinholes. We can use different type of patterns. The system can learn from there. Well, thank you very much for your time. And if you want to know more, feel free to contact me anytime or go to our website.